if I get the good bit, really, of saying where the emergency exits are, and I'm sure that you've been to the previous meetings that we've had recently, but in the event of an emergency, please, if somebody says emergency or out as soon as possible, the three exits at the back, one straight down, one either side, that way. There is also one behind me, through the choir vestry there. It's only a narrow exit, really, and it is fairly restricted. But please make your way to your nearest exit in the event of an emergency. It would also be helpful if you could either turn off or put your mobile phones into the silent position so as not to disturb this time that we have together. So, on saying that, welcome to you all, and I will now hand over to Sir Geoffrey Newman, who will share his speech.
Thank you, Bob. Welcome back again. Just to reinforce the fact that I am not involved in any of the things going on, perhaps, that we discussed tonight, I'm not sitting on any kind of board. I'm hoping I can be a true and faithful chair, neutral as possible. So just to let you know that. I'm going to introduce our Member of Parliament, Sarah Wollaston, in a minute. And she's going to give you a brief talk. But then, the opportunity for you to give the questions. But before you do that, I want you to stand up and say who you are. Because we need to hear and see who you are. So be thinking what you're going to say. But I'll be grateful if it's the constituents of Dartmouth and District who are speaking tonight. And I would hope that they are the people who want to hear the responses from Sarah. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Sarah, our Member of Parliament.
I've looked after people in community hospitals, I've worked alongside alongside the staff of community hospitals. So I know why this matters to people and why people are upset. But I thought I would also just start by reflecting over the years in my time as a very rural GP in an isolated community, how practice has changed and some of the challenges that we face that we have to be, I think, realistic about. I want to reflect on that and some of the work that I've done in Parliament on this as well. And that is that when I first started in the community hospital, very many more people were looked after in community hospitals for conditions that where we've now changed the approach. So for example, when people have a stroke or a heart attack, now you don't want to go to the nearest small hospital. You want to go to a very specialist centre and be looked after there. The other thing, though, is that how dangerous being in a hospital bed can be for frail elderly people. And it really is the case that wherever possible, your own bed is the best bed. Because being incapacitated in a community hospital setting, just as in a hospital setting, if you could be at home and supported to get up and about, we know that's the best thing. So many things have changed, but I do know that there are some things that happen in community hospitals, particularly in communities like Dartmouth, which really will always remain very important. Things like palliative care, for example. The ability to have, sometimes to be admitted to have intravenous drug treatments. Things like that. But as I say, healthcare and the way you deliver it is changing. And I think the basic model of aiming wherever possible to support people at home with what's called intermediate care, so with step up and step down care, trying to avoid a hospital admission if at all possible, and obviously where a hospital admission is necessary, we should make sure that happens, but where it can be avoided, it's much better to be at home or in a, what's called step up or intermediate care. And also, getting people out of hospital. It used to be that people would spend long periods of time in hospital. The number of days that people stay in hospital beds now is coming down. And that's partly because we recognise that should be our key drive, wherever possible, to get people out, back in their own communities and home. And the other challenge, of course, we can't get away from this, is the financial challenge that we face across health and care. Now, I'm just mentioning it because I think we need to touch on what the problems that we face. And also, we need to touch on the workforce challenge. The workforce challenge that we have. Wollaston Hospital didn't close because of financial problem. It changed because of the workforce problem. They couldn't safely staff it. And that wasn't because they weren't looking. And the other thing I would say is that the role of the workforce in community hospitals and the expectations changed even over the decade I was there. So they now move to where you're seeing somebody in a community hospital, for example, in a minor injuries unit. Those staff have to maintain a certain level of training so that you can expect the same standard of care and a member of staff who's as experienced in keeping their skills refreshed there as you would do anywhere else. So the requirements of the numbers that people have to be treating and the requirements of the training got much more onerous. And that means that the minimum numbers that you need to have through prison have changed, and as I say, the training requirements. So there are lots of challenges that we face. And I think the direction of travel to try and aim wherever possible to get people out of hospital is the right direction to go. But I do understand how much community hospitals mean to people and why everyone's upset. And I think had Riverview gone ahead as planned, I think it would have been a really good model. Because we have to look at the challenges not just around what happens in community hospitals, but around the whole of primary care. And we know that the health centre in Dartmouth isn't in the right premises. One of the challenges they face in recruitment can be helped if they're working from modern premises where they can have lots of people in training, working together under one roof with clinics and working alongside fantastic organisations like Dartmouth Caring. That would be deliberately use this as an excuse to close the hospital, I'm not saying so. But to me, that is not the case. A lot of people from across this community and in the trust really work very hard to try and make that work, I assure you. And the fact that it fell through, everyone is devastated that that fell through. But what I would say is that we should now focus on what we can achieve. And I know that there are a lot of people here this evening who feel very strongly, and I can understand that, very strongly that we should reopen the old community hospital. I'm going to be completely honest with you and say I don't think that's possible. But I do think what we absolutely need to do is focus on where we're going from here and putting all the energy that we can as a community into what we can get for Dartmouth. And I'm very pleased that Liz Davenport has come back this evening, as has John Tucker, the leader of the council, to give you an update on where we are now. Because I know that the message you wanted to deliver to them last time round was, let's get on with it, let's see what we're doing. So I thought it would be best if they came back now to give you an update on progress, and then I'm going to resume. Thank you. Thank you very much, John. Yes.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And over the last few weeks, especially since my review fell through, the South Down Social Council have been working very closely with the South Down National NHS Trust to find a solution. And I'm very pleased to say that we believe we found a solution for Dartmouth. And what Southampton have offered the nature of the trust, and I will give you what we've offered. And at this time, I believe Liz and the team are willing to continue discussions with us. But the land behind the park and ride site, which gets used as an overflow site for car parking, what we're looking to do there is actually give the land, well, not give the land to the trust, but the land is free. We will quite happily build, that's the district council will build, the requirements that the trust would like to see on that site to accommodate the needs of Dartmouth. Sometimes the district council will retain the ownership of that building. And for that, we will ask for a return, which is obviously a discussion we know between officers of the district council and the trust themselves. So, what we're saying is we can build one, and it depends on the design and everything else, then the trust, not me, and not South Down Council. But we have a solution for Dartmouth. It will take a little time, something will happen next week. We have to get those solutions in place in the contract. But once that's happened, we believe we can move forward at a pretty reasonable space, or pace, not space. But so I think, from my point of view, I'm delighted that I can stand here and say that, because I think it is a solution for Dartmouth. It may not be an ideal, but it is a solution when you get a new premises, which will be the most modern you can get. Well, I will say that there's not many people who can stand up and say that we're in new premises. So, with that, let's hand over to you.
Thank you very much, Councillor Tucker. We are absolutely delighted to be able to be in a position to work in partnership with the District Council to create a health and wellbeing centre. When I came here in May, we did talk a lot about the huge disappointment, and I personally was hugely disappointed that the plans that we had in place in relation to Riverview didn't work. But we were always really, really committed to find the right solution for Dartmouth. And we're really optimistic through this innovative partnership that we will be able to work together to get the right design and put the services for Dartmouth in that health and wellbeing centre at the top of the town where Councillor Tucker has mentioned. It is something we'll be doing, working closely with our GP colleagues, picking up some of Sarah's comments around primary care and the importance of having fit for purpose GP practices as well as our health and wellbeing services on that site. Thank you.
Liz, thank you very much, dear John. Will you just sit down here? Are you ready? Okay, John is here, ready with the microphone.
So if we're in a position now for any questions, I'd be glad to do that. And you've got many people here behind who are going to answer questions. I've got a lady by the pillar there, underneath the light, right there. John, are you ready to go, please? Well, right over there, where you go? Quick. And just give your name and...
Liz Rowe. I have been a resident in Dartmouth for over 30 years. Our hospital served us very well. You are not replacing it now. You're replacing it in perhaps 5 years' time. What do we do in between?
Elderly couple supporting each other at home.
and really one who's absolutely worn out, they'll admit the one who's most in need and the other one can go and be cared for by themselves for a few days by a relative or something. But my letter did actually, even though the paper cut bits out, it did define exactly, I think, what we need. I googled prefab hospital units, and there's loads of them. You could have one thing with four beds, six beds, all sorts, and they can be up in a matter of weeks. Yeah. If you've got the land, why can't you put up at least something that can be grown upon? Now, later in my life, when the second Iraq war, no, the first Iraq war came, I was working as a major teaching hospital then, and I was one of the senior staff that had to pull together and suddenly be able to take, we thought, lots of burns people from Kuwait. They didn't actually happen, did they? But it just shows the NHS can organise itself in about 3 days.
Jane, look, absolutely fantastic, Jane. I think we've got the question is, what is actually going to happen in a health and wellbeing centre?
Right, okay. Well, what we have to do is look at the whole of what we call primary care. So that's everything from when you're seeing a GP, whether or not we can bring hospital clinics out to the community to save people having to travel, what happens if you need to see a physiotherapist, somebody who's helping you with a mental health issue. So it's bringing lots of clinics into under one roof, also alongside, for example, a pharmacy, alongside voluntary services like Dartmouth Caring. So you're actually looking at all the ways you can support people, but crucially having all those people under one roof so they can talk to each other. Because one of the key issues in healthcare is communication. But it's also, I have to tell you, recruitment. And I think you made some really important points, but actually recruiting staff. Because of the issues that I mentioned about the need for people to keep their skills up and be rotating around, is a real challenge in rural isolated communities. And I think, although, as you mentioned, if we're in an acute wartime situation where we need to get in and put up a prefab hospital, we can do that in those situations. Even if we were to bring those into Dartmouth now, we wouldn't be able to safely staff it, I suspect. And it's the staffing challenge in rural isolated communities as much as anything else. And things have changed. And as we know, the demographic of this southland has changed enormously. And the other challenge we face in this community is the cost of housing, so that we can have enough people living here and actually restore a more balanced demographic so that younger families can afford to live in this area. And I'd just like, if I may, Geoffrey, just to touch on that point as well, because I think this lies at the heart of a lot of the challenges we face in our Southlands, is affordable housing, housing that key workers can afford to live in. And this week I went with a delegation of my colleagues to see the Prime Minister to actually talk about that, to talk about some of the mechanisms that you can use to try and move towards having more genuinely affordable housing. Because I think that sometimes the housing challenge is seen through the prism of what's happening in big cities, what's happening in London, all the big cities outside London, rather than looking particularly at what happens in an area like ours, where we have very, very high housing costs, very high levels. Oh, yeah.
I've got a gentleman at the back there, Kevin.
Thank you. Sarah, firstly, and I have to be hard and I have to say, I think you've forgotten us. Yeah. I think you're spending too much time. I voted for you and I voted for you with an open heart. You're not spending enough time with us. Secondly, if Torbay Hospital, who have been proven to be wanting to the point of lying, feel so strongly that they're going to do all these things to us together with the town council, will they now speak to our Dartmouth Hospital liaison group? Will they now open the Cottage Hospital until such time as we can walk in the doors of this other hospital, should it be fit for purpose? And will you please realise that we don't come from Torbay, we come from the South Hams. We're not fast cats whizzing around in the second-hand BMWs. We like living the way we like to live, and we like our hospitals the way they are. And I can speak as a former inpatient in Dartmouth. Well, I spent 9 weeks convalescing after Torbay Hospital got an operation on me so badly wrong that I nearly died. And Dartmouth Hospital were fantastic. My wife, who was suffering from cancer, had palliative care until she eventually died in Dartmouth Hospital. It's not a hospital. It's a part of us. It's in our culture. It's in our psyche. And you're not realising what we're saying. And all the smart answers in the world are going over our heads because we believe in common, ordinary Christian care for those about us. Thank you.
Is going to be built. What is going to happen now?
Well, I think, may I just start by addressing the other point? Because I am actually very disappointed at the way it's been portrayed as if somehow I was involved in it. One of the first things that I did when Simon Stevens took on his role as the head of the NHS was invite him to Dartmouth. I brought the head of the NHS to Dartmouth Hospital to show him just how much it matters to the community. I was there at the consultations. I was there actually talking about this, and you know, I was there at that Newton Abbott meeting asking if we could keep the community hospital open until our time was in place. But I think that even though
promised.
I chair the health, and even though I chair the health select committee in Parliament, I have no powers to force. And that influence I tried very hard to use. As I say, actually getting the head of the NHS to come down to Dartmouth when he was just starting, shortly after he started his role, to actually talk to him about rural healthcare. And I wanted him to come to Dartmouth because I realised Dartmouth was vulnerable. And I have to tell you, when he came to visit Dartmouth Hospital, actually, what he saw was a lot of empty beds, I'm afraid. Were actually being used for people who didn't come from Dartmouth at all. Sometimes we just have to be very honest about the situation we're in. I would love to have seen this hospital remain open, and I don't accept that I didn't actually make representations on your behalf that that was what the community wanted. I did that. I was there at those consultation meetings. Well before this process started, and at the end of where we are now, I was there at those meetings and represented the views of this community. But what I do have to be honest with you is I have no powers to stop it. And what I do think is that when you know a community hospital is going to close, you can do two things. You can say, well, that's fine, there's nothing there in this place, or you can say, I'm going to do everything I can to try and get something in its place that will be of huge value. And I think that the plans for Riverview, had they gone ahead, would have been excellent. But that's it, we're all viewing this from the perspective of it having fallen through. But we were very, very nearly there. A few of the events happened right at the 11th hour that made this fall through. And I think that, although I can understand you're all very angry with me, I know that that's part of what happens. People understand they are angry. But as I say, I think that what we sometimes don't recognise is the amount of effort that has gone in. And it's very easy to say, you've forgotten this, you don't care. I can assure you that is absolutely not the case. And I realise that it's difficult. Sometimes people see me talking about all sorts of other things when I'm in my role chairing the health committee. I spent all day yesterday, for example, in Belmarsh Crescent. Yeah, there we are. I think that was a good thing. But actually, I do spend a lot of time trying to pick up. And the reason that we're holding an inquiry into prison healthcare is not because I'm ignoring Dartmouth, but because one of my constituents came to see me to talk about her grandson having taken his own life in prison. And it was such a moving conversation. And sometimes, actually, what you have to recognise is that there are issues that profoundly affect some of our lives in this community, but they might not immediately be apparent why inquiring, say, prison healthcare is something that matters. Well, it does matter deeply to some of my constituents.
We need an answer on that, what's going to happen between now and the wellbeing centre, but that might come in a minute. Gentlemen here, please.
I was given the microphone. I'm Jenny Schoberg from Dittisham. I'm in one of the villages outside of Dartmouth. I absolutely understand the concerns of everybody about the hospital. It's not necessarily the best place for everybody to get to in the outlying areas. I'm very pleased to hear that there's some progress being made. I would also like to say that I know Sarah works very hard for her constituents. She's worked very hard for me personally. And I think it's a bit unfair to say that she has forgotten us. I don't think she has. I think she's working hard in the background. But I do understand everybody's concerns. Something does need to be done. And I really would like to know how many nursing beds there will be in the new health and wellbeing fair, or whatever it's called, centre.
Yes.
If there will be some beds, then nursing beds.
Right.
Thank you.
Now, my understanding at the moment is that there won't be nursing beds, but it will be a centre which is around primary care. My own feeling, and I hope that we can, one of the issues for the health service is the health service doesn't commission residential care beds and nursing home care beds. And I think that what I would like to see happen next is for us to look at what the shortages of nursing home beds across the whole of the South Downs. In my view, we have a particular problem with those who have dementia who have higher needs in dementia. And I'd like to see us take a whole system-wide look at what we need in terms of residential and nursing care and see whether there is any possibility of seeing whether the council could work together with the NHS to look at what options we have if we have some land. Say, is there something that needs some residential care alongside the health and wellbeing centre? But my understanding is that at the moment there are no plans to have actual nursing beds, but I will just check my people beds and that's the thing. That is correct at the moment. But as I say, if we look at what the needs are of our whole community, the biggest needs we have is around, if you look at what's happening, have any of you been to visit the new development in Totnes, for example, along the riverside there, where they've actually got a fantastic development. But the development they have there is around supported higher needs housing so for the community. And I would just urge you to go and have a look and see what you can achieve by looking at housing needs that can then move into the much higher levels of support as people get older. Because there's a real shortage of that in the South Downs, and there is a shortage of certain types of residential and nursing.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you very much. Mike,
well. Hello, sir. You may remember me. Mike Wills, I'm the chairman of the Dartmouth Area Healthcare Action Group,
yes,
which came into being as a result of meeting here on the 14th of May, where a lot of discontent was vented about the situation. And I think there's a number of issues here. Thinking about all this, what I concluded is that there are actually five main groups involved in the healthcare for people here, and at the moment maybe we're only focusing on the Trust and CCG. The other groups who are involved are NHS England, the Devon County Council, and the Ambulance Service. And I start to wonder, when you start looking at different things, whether some people are saving money on their budgets, but they're increasing costs in some other place. Just an example to consider, I don't know what the answer is. If we have nurses going out to people in their homes to attend to their dressings or give them medication, how many visits can they do in a day compared to somebody in a hospital? Now, I think the issue here is clearly coming out, isn't it? Is the number of beds that are going to be available for people who need intermediate care. I have a personal experience which I know many people in this room have had. I had it with my elderly mother who had an unfortunate broken hip some years ago. She had it fixed in the hospital, they did a wonderful job, which is what they do. She was then ultimately moved to Dartmouth and she was there for about 4 weeks. I can tell you without any doubt, I'm sure many other people will tell you, there is no way she could have been cared for at home and got over that operation she had. Sit down and look at them and try to piece them together and put together a viable, sensible option that works for everyone. Not just the trust, not just the CCG, but it includes the community. All of us here want a solution that works for us as well. We've heard all the bits before about cost. We understand all that. We're not stupid. But we do want a sensible, viable solution that gets us to this wonderful idea, and I congratulate you for tonight, congratulate the Southampton District Council for offering that plan. But again, we need to look into what is that wellbeing centre going to be. Thank you very much.
The pillar there. That's right. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Good evening, sir. Harry French, Dartmouth again. I think why a lot of Dartmouth people are really upset. We went through this consultation thing at the Academy, at the Council Hall, and you were at the meetings, and we were sold this Riverview idea, and everything was going ahead, it's all going to be wonderful. And the promise was made that Dartmouth Hospital would not close until everything was up and running.
Thing that I did say is please can we keep one open till the other at least opens. But there was no promise made that that's happened because I was asking if that would be possible. But as I say, of course I'm sad, but I genuinely, absolutely do not think that this was some kind of ruse to sort of promise one thing.
It wasn't you who promised it, it was the healthcare trust.
I think that this was a property deal that fell through. This was so nearly there. And it's very easy for people to be, I understand why people are angry, but genuinely a lot of people put a huge amount of effort into trying to make Riverview happen. And it wasn't. I absolutely convinced it was not a ruse to somehow get people to be agreeing to one thing.
But why was the hospital shut before it was up and running?
Well,
that's the question we need to
ask.
Similar ages that they can just communicate with. But you never mentioned that.
Well, I'm very happy. Okay, well, let me talk about Dartmouth Care. There's Dartmouth Care.
Suffering from a common governmental problem, one size
fits all. And we are not in that category. We've not got easy transport to other places. You say about people being better off at home than in a hospital bed. I don't see an elderly person stuck in a bed on a first or second floor flat being any better off than being in hospital. In fact, they're probably worse off. What we need is economies of scale. Put the people who need the treatment together where a smaller number of nurses could look after them properly instead of travelling all over the area. It's a very widespread area that we are in, and they will probably spend more time travelling between patients than doing their proper work.
Yep.
You're going to have to sacrifice all you've achieved in your own career to be remembered for your role in the asset-stricken and death of our beautiful NHS, or you can join us. Are you with us or are you against us?
Just to finish off, welcome, thank you for coming. I know we're putting you through a terrible...
Well, that's my job.
Basically, what you're hearing is that we are a town betrayed. We are absolutely devastated at the way all of this has turned out. We're devastated at the loss of our hospital.
Sorry. All I'm saying is that we're a town betrayed, basically. While we remember your passionate statement in 2010, I wonder if you remember. You said that I did not apply for this job because I wanted to leave my old one. Being a rural GP and part-time teacher has been a great privilege. I applied because I honestly believe that we need more doctors and nurses to bring common sense to health debates and to try and put a clinician's perspective in policy making. And there has been little evidence up until now that the needs of communities outside of London and major cities have been taken into account. So what is my prescription for the NHS? Alongside a lot of other things, you said, protection for community hospitals, which is so vital to Brixham and the South Hams. What has changed?
Exactly as I thought it. I've worked in community hospitals. I understand why this is a loss for this community. Do not get me wrong. I understand that. What I would say is, I still think, and I really do believe, that I bring a clinician's perspective into Parliament. I talk a huge amount about the NHS and social care. And I am very sorry that I was not able to save your community hospital. What I'm trying to explain to you is that as we go forward and we look at the whole system challenge that we have across primary care, about general practice, recruiting general practice, and we look, start where we are, say this is where we are, community hospital has closed. What is the very best we can now get for this community?
Spend 300,000 and open the hospital.
One thing is, that even if you were to reopen it with 16 beds, the challenge would be the same around trying to staff it.
No problem. It's
very challenging to staff community hospitals. That is why Northern Hampshire Hospital closed. It closed because they couldn't recruit the staff to keep it open. It is about the change of and applying the evidence. And the evidence is very, I'm afraid, is very clear that your own bed is the best one. Standard required with disabled access. the electorate, said Jimmy. I'm afraid I'm not an expert in this, but if people want me to try and get hold of the detailed costings and breakdown, of course I'm delighted to do that. I'm really happy that people are going to look seriously at all the options. And of course that should be one of the options, to say, is there a possibility of repurposing that site in some other way to keep community, you know, keep residential and nursing beds. But my understanding, what I've been told, is that the cost of doing that would be huge. But I think all options should be explored.
Many of the with John now. Put the microphone up a bit.
Nursing intermediate care beds. There are none available, and for that to happen, we would need to have a nursing home.
That's right, and I think that is a shortage across the South Downs. So I think that what we should do is look at the needs of the whole community, and it's not just Dartmouth, it's the villages surrounding, and say what do we need in terms of nursing home beds as well as residential homes, because that is a real shortage.
But how?
They should look at the whole thing. They should look across social care and health and what happens in nursing home beds as well, because that's what we have also lost in this community.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Brooker. Why do you want to be there, John? That's right.
My name is Ken Anders, and I'm the chair of PPG. And I want to thank you, Chair, for offering together some more information. I think one of the really sad things about this whole site is the way in which information has drip out. The numbers keep changing, the facts keep slightly modifying, and we can never get the full story. I think it's a really important that all the facts are put on the table so we have full transparency about the way the various decisions were made and the considerations between different. And that's been impossible. I mean, we have never been able to get facts. We keep asking for facts, and we get them sort of one at a time, and that hasn't been satisfactory. I think the other thing is that the care bed situation is chronic. I mean, it's all very well to say you're going to purchase one or two beds from the care home. Well, there's only one care home that's actually functioning in Dartmouth, and it's only got a few beds. It's desperately in need of more beds. And there's a wait, and so, I mean, and why can't we get more care beds? Because the business of care homes is no longer viable. Why is it no longer viable? Because the government has cut back the amount of money they're prepared to put into social care so that the care homes are shutting. And how can you expect the strategy to work if the key aspect of this, which is the provision of care beds in the private sector, is not an economic proposition under the current funding?
I'd like to respond to that. That's a key piece that is missing. We've heard announcements this week about NHS funding increases, but social care was missing from that. Next week, my committee will be publishing our report on social care and how we should fund it. We absolutely have to fund social care better in this country. Without that, we're not going to be able to address any of the issues around the NHS, because when social care is failing, then I'm afraid that has knock-on costs for the NHS, as one person said earlier, the way the costs pass around the system. And the challenge with social care is that we all know that we have to think about who is going to pay for that and how we're going to pay for it. So one of the things that we looked at with our committee was using a very large type of systems jury, systems assembly, to look at all the various options for how we should go about fairly funding social care. But if we were to start from scratch now and say, how do we divide up resources between health and social care, we wouldn't want to be where we are now. Because social care gets such a tiny fraction total resource. But we have a huge challenge. I don't believe there's any massive dividend, as I said this week. And I think that the uplift that we're going to see for the NHS is going to come from all of us as taxpayers. And what we now need is a realistic discussion about how that is fairly going to be raised. And the Chancellor, I went to see the Chancellor as well this week, I had half an hour with the Chancellor talking to him about the challenges and how you're actually going to realistically raise this money. But Pierre, unless we can pay more for social care beds, then I'm afraid we're not going to be able to solve this.
To pay more for the NHS.
Sir, I wrote to you actually about the hospital facilities, and you very kindly responded to me, and I actually got your email on the 20th. That's Crystal, by the way, sorry, I should say that at the beginning. It's just two points in your reply which I'd just like clarification on. The first one was, you said that the Trust would be more than happy to share the findings and the decision making that went behind where we are today. And I actually went the other day to the Dartmouth Healthcare Action Group, and one of the points that came out was how they were struggling to get this information about the reports and obviously feasibility studies and everything that went in for arriving at this decision why Dartmouth Hospital was not suitable to carry on. Could you help us through the Trust so that we can get this information and these reports that reach those decisions? Because as we are at the moment, we still have not got those reports or information within this action group. And bearing in mind that action group had the support of most of the people here at the meeting that was held by Mike Matthews, who spoke earlier to you. Could you help us on that as our MP?
Absolutely. As your MP, one of my goals, and I do it for individuals and organisations, is to try and find background information.
And will that be through this? Would that be?
Indeed. So if you have specific pieces of information that you would like me to try and get hold of for you, I will be more than happy to try and do that. And you can ask me, and through me, I will then be passing on your request.
So I guess that will go through the Dartmouth Action.
Yes. First and foremost, of course, it's nice if organisations respond directly to you, but the way you're not getting the kind of answers. Of course, sometimes people ask questions and actually the information doesn't exist in the form in which it's being asked. But where there is information that I can ask the Trust to forward you, where that's not forthcoming, then please do get in touch.
Sure. And the second part of the response, just a bit of clarification, was, and you've actually stated again tonight, that you do not have the power to overturn or, as you put it in your words, dictate to the Trust. Who does?
Right.
If it's not our MP, who is it?
Well, the thing is that health has a lot of decision making, sort of, if you like, operational decisions about how the money is spent, has been devolved. So it's been taken away from Westminster and politicians and given to the Trust and the commissioners. And what they have a responsibility to do is to look at the needs of the whole population they cover. And so sometimes they make decisions that for an individual community absolutely feel worse. But it means that they can then have money to spend over the whole patch. And the fact is, an MP cannot say, you will not do it. There are no powers for an MP to prevent it, unless there's been the process has failed in some way. So you can make a challenge if the process can be followed. But in fact, they did follow the process.
So the only way I guess that you can evaluate whether that's happened or not is to see the reports, the feasibility studies, and everything that went into making these decisions. Because without that, you can't evaluate whether it's been done or not.
Well, certainly, if there is information that you're not getting that you would like me to help you to get, then I'm more than happy to
Thank
try
you.
And
answer. You've got your answer there. John, someone down here, but I'm going to ask you to say out loud to everybody what you want to say, because the microphone is going to take a while to get two people.
Just joking.
I would like to talk about social care.
Yes.
I've spoken before on this issue, and Mrs. Davenport gave us a speech about her thoughts on this and how it was going to work, and it would be very nice for everyone to have home care. Everyone wanted to have home care. Well, now, my husband and I have been on the receiving end of this. My husband was in hospital in Torbay, back to Dartmouth Hospital, 2 or 3 times. Then Dartmouth Hospital said, no, I'm sorry, you've got to go home, Mr. King. Well, that was fine. We thought, yes, that would be nice, have my husband home. So we had the carers in. We had 2 or 3 different lots of carers. One was came from Torquay. They had cars. They couldn't park. So we decided, we'll try another local agency who had carers. Now, some of the carers, one or two of them managed to get to the house in time. 2 or 3 of them had to use buses, so that wasn't very satisfactory because we never knew when they were coming. Anyway, then we went to another caring company, and they couldn't cope because they couldn't park anywhere. The parking was terrible in Dartmouth. In consequence, they were never on time, or very seldom, I shouldn't say never, very seldom on time for the appointment when they were due to do their duties. And invariably, these carers were only in the property for about 30 minutes time. And the rush was on because they had to get on to the next one. Now, that is our own experience. But eventually, of course, I was looking after my husband. We both landed up on the floor one night. And so we had to get the emergency people in. My husband, in consequence, fortunately, is at Beacon House, which is very, very nice. But there is such a need for this. And Beacon House has not got many Dartmouth people in. They're all over from Southampton because they can't find anywhere. But so it really does need. It's all right until you get to the stage when someone can get up. And quite honestly, we hear about having training new carers. Young new carers don't want to wash old people's bottoms. They clean up their napkins and wash the linen. It's not a job for young people. It's a job for mature people who really know what they're doing, who are caring and emotionally broke to cope with the situation.
Thank you very much. Okay, everybody.
We have an opportunity for another question. And then Sarah said she is available here for those who want to have a chat to her about anything else. Okay, so there's an opportunity to do that. But I want to go for one more question, please. And the gentleman in blue there, please.
Gentleman in blue, yes.
And in the meantime, Sarah's going to be thinking about what she's going to say. Sarah's going to be thinking about what she's going to say in kind of response, kind of putting it all together, the kind of things she can do. All right, she'd be thinking about that now after your question.
Thank you. Sarah, let's cut to the chase. Isn't all this asset stripping that's been going on across the South Hands is just a preparation for privatisation?
Yes. Yes.
No. It's your answer. And
so that's
what
you urge
you to do. I would urge you to do is look at the cross-party report that we published a couple of weeks ago on the whole issue of all the acronyms we get here. We have in the NHS around ICSs, ACOs, ICOs, the STPs. Nobody knows what any of them are. And if you want to find out what they all mean and what they're all about, then have a look at our report because we've tried to cut through all the nonsense. But one of the things we specifically wanted to look at was whether some of the moves which are trying to join up organisations so that they can work more closely together across the NHS and social care, is that really, as some people claim, just a ruse to sort of privatise it, the accountable yes. care organisation? Yes. Well, what we have said is that they should be public bodies in response to your question. I urge you to look at our report. We've been very clear that we think they should be in public ownership. But we also feel there's been a great deal of unnecessary scaremongering about so-called Americanisation of the NHS. the fundamental principle that your care is free at the point of use, based on need and not ability to pay, is absolutely the same. And we think, and the evidence that we heard a little bit ago, half of my committee are Labour MPs, we looked at the evidence on this, and what we feel is that this is an opportunity to row back the internal market of the NHS, to actually take us away from these endless wasteful contracting rounds in the NHS, so, and to see us having more public ownership and less wasteful rounds of commissioning and contracting, to return to something that genuinely looks across all communities and gets the NHS and social care working together. So, as I say, there was a long answer to a short question, but we have recommended that ACOs are in public ownership, and I've urge you to look at our report. So, and I think I just want to very quickly touch on a very, very important story that we heard, and that is, I think that social care is absolutely key to making this work. But it's, what I'd say to you is, it's not just about money, it's about workforce. And if we look around our communities, we also have to say it's around housing. So we have to look at several things. We have to look at public health, that's the prevention arm of the NHS. We have to look at social care. We have to look at what's happening in primary care. We have to look at mental health. And we have to look across the whole picture. And I'm afraid there are challenges. And one of the key challenges is around workforce. So I'm very conscious that some people feel that perhaps I've somehow abandoned this community. I really assure you that is not the case. It is true that as an MP, I have to spend 4 days of my week in London. That is kind of the job I signed up for. When Parliament is sitting, I am in Parliament Monday to Thursday. And that's why, unfortunately, I wasn't able to make the two previous meetings on Monday evening, because that is my job, is to be there Monday to Thursday. But a lot of what I do in Parliament, in my role as a Select Committee Chair, is always trying to refocus on how that affects us in this community and in rural communities as well, to try and get the focus out of London, out of the big cities, and think about how things like social care work here in Devon, how our local NHS works as well. And in closing, I have heard your message loud and clear that you are still hugely, hugely upset about the loss of our community hospital.
Yeah.
Of course I've heard that message. But what I would say is that I do not believe that community hospital will open. And I could give you a whole load of plans about this, but I have to be straight with you and say that I think the best thing we can do now is focus on saying, what do we need for the whole community? Look at primary care, look at mental health, look at social care, look at what we can achieve, look at the opportunity of having a piece of land at the top of the town, and what do we want to do to get the best out of it? But I want to close on one final note, and that's the thing that's upset me more than people feeling angry with me, because that's kind of my job, that's what I get. But I am genuinely upset for some of the most amazing people I meet in Dartmouth caring. So I would really like you to see a picture of you, a fantastic job.
No, don't.
Sarah, thank you very much indeed, Sarah. Look, I know there's more questions.
Did we get an answer to when the new place is going to be open?
Oh, very good point.
Did we actually get an answer?
Do we get an answer of when it's going to be done?
The new fantasy place.
With the NHS, and there is no reason why we can't move forward pretty quickly, because we know.
Look, when is the new place going to open?
Let's say 2 years.
Two years? It took them 60 to build the swimming pool.
2 years.
If I said 2 years and it took 2 years, 2 months, we'd be back here again.
We all know it's going to be 5 years at least. Because nothing
moves
quick down.
That's your opinion.
It's not an opinion, it's a fact. Nothing moves that quick. Nothing.
The swimming pool is not at the end of the day. What's the
Okay, all right. I know. I'm not building hospitals at the moment.
Then?
I promise you, I'm not building hospitals.
Did we get an answer?
No, you are going to get an answer.
Are we?
You are going to get an answer, but I don't think at the moment the answer is quite there. You want to say?
No, I'd just like to say thank you very much again to all of you for coming. I know there's some people usually at the end of the meeting like to catch me and ask something individually. Some individuals have things they want to say, but they don't want to say in public. So I will, as we all go out, if anyone wants to catch me for an individual question. The point is that there's a very one point is I can't give you that answer.
Who can?
Well, the answer is it's in our hands as a community.
In the hands, in the hands.
Constructively as possible to work to say what we want to do with that site, how we want it to look, and everybody will be working as quickly as they can to make it happen, because I've heard what you said. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you all very much indeed. A big thank you for coming. And thank you very much indeed. See you again, I'm sure, on another occasion, safely away tonight. Thank you.